So in this topic, we will see how to use MPLAB compiler and simulator, and later on we will see how to write a program, simulate and download it. So to install MPLAB, there is a folder in SW folder of Mtron PIC MPLAB ID version 8.86. So there is a setup file is there. Just double click this software to install MPLAB compiler. After installation, the software is ready for writing the program, but since we want to write the program for PIC controller, which is the family of 18F4550, so you need to install a additional driver which is called MPLAB 18B3.46, which is for C18 compiler. So this is meant for 18F series controllers programming. So that is available in the software folder. There is a MPLAB C18-V3.46. So you need to install this software. So this completes the installation of the software for so we have installed both the softwares. Now we need to install a driver file so that when we connect our board to the computer through USB, we will be programming. So you require some .NET drivers, which is there in folder net folder. As you can see, there is a setup file, netcfs setup file is there. This driver file, you install it so that you can use the USB driver. So now we are ready. Let us start the MPLAB. This MPLAB 8.86 version is the compiler. So go to project first. In project wizard, you can say next. So yes, we are using the controller 18F4550. So select this device only. Next, we need to give the path for the compiler. As you can see, the active tool suite, you have several companies have different compilers. We are using Microchip C18 tool suite. So this need to be selected, active tool suite. So for the entire example programs, we are using Microchip C18 compiler. So once you have selected, then as you can see, the list of assembler, linker, compiler are given. So you have to set the path where these are all existing. Say for example, if I selected the first one, now you can go to the browser, now where this fellow is existing. So as you can see, the path for that in C directory, program file, in Microchip, MPLAB 18V3.4.6, MPASM, in that this MPASM win.exe is there. So that is what you will have to set the path for these softwares where they are installed. Similarly, you can see the other MP linker is again in the bin folder of that. We have to select that in the same folder and C18 and so on. So these are all existing there. You just have to give the path for these programs where they are existing. So once that is done, then you can say next. Okay, now you are ready to create a project. So you can give some name of the project, or you can where it is going to be saved, right? You can give the name of the file, say for example save. Okay, next. Okay, now this is asking for, do you want to add any libraries or the C files or assembly lang files? If they are already existing, they can, you can add them, or otherwise say next and finish. Now your workspace is created where the project is created. Now you can see you can add the source files, you can add the header files so that you can use them, the existing files, or else you can create a new file. Now, as you can see, when you say create a new file, you type your program, then save it and give the same name as a path here, so that this file, source file, is part of your project. So MCP is your name of the project, and under that you can have to have the add the, is for example add the files. So if you already have some files, either assembly language or C program files, you'll have to add it. Similarly, in the header also, if you have any libraries to be added, you add them. Most importantly, in linker, you have to add the file of 4550, because we are using the USB driver, so that it won't override the your application program won't override on linker file. So let us see various examples of PIC controller. The first example is LED program. So as we know, in the board, apart from the power LED, there are two LEDs are connected on port A, PA, port A, A4 and A5, which is a common cathode. So on the board, they are named as LED2 and LED3, which is placed LED2, LED3 after the power LED. As you can see, this is the power LED. So let us write a program to blink these two LEDs, which are connected on port A4 and A5. So in the examples, you can go to project in MPLAB IDE, and then you can open the first example in the folder, Mtron PIC examples, Mtron LED1. So you can open this. So in this program, first, as we have discussed in the earlier video, the programming is done through USB. So there is already a bootloader which is existing in the controller. So with the help of that bootloader, we are loading the application program into the flash memory. So for that purpose, if you see the initial part of the program, after the header file included in the program, we have initially included some code. So this, as you can see, these are called interrupt vectors. For example, reset interrupt vector, and then there is a high interrupt vector, low interrupt vector, which is the reserved memory locations for the interrupt service routines. So since we are using the USB bootloader for to load the application programs, so in every program, the beginning of the code, that is up to where we have used the program code, that has to be there, which is a interrupt vector initialization. So the main program starts from here, where void main. Since we want to switch on the LEDs, so the port of port A, we want to make it as a output port. So for that, the direction of the port is decided by the register called TRIS register. Okay, so let us see the data sheet in page 113 of the data sheet. As you can see, how the ports of the PIC controller are designed. So as you can see, there is a latch, there is a data latch, and there is a TRIS register latch, and there is a port latch is there. So basically, we have three registers. One is called port, second is called TRIS, and third is called LAT, that is a latch. So for a port A, we have port A, TRIS A, and latch A. These are the three registers which are associated with every port. So here, if you carefully see, the direction of the port is depending on this TRIS register. So whatever you write into this register, if you write the data into this register, then can the output of the TRIS register is deciding this tri-state buffer, whether the contents of the port is output available here or this tri-state buffer is disabled. So if this is disabled, that means the contents are, you cannot write onto the port, you can only read from the port. So that is where this TRIS latch register is deciding whether you want to write the contents to the port or you want to read contents from the port. So the direction is decided by the TRIS register. Second register is called latch register. So if you write anything to this latch register, then you can see the contents are available at the output port, provided this TRIS register has enabled the output port. So these contents, you can write it on the port. You can also read the contents of the latch register by using read latch, using the read latch instruction. Similarly, third is, there is a register called port register. So if you write the data into this port register, as you can see, you can write the data to this post register, then these contents are, you can read it. But however, basically the port register is meant for to read the IO lines. You can see the output, the pins of the microcontroller are connected to this port register, so that if you read the contents, then these are available in the latch and you can read the contents. So for read operation, you better use the port register. For write operation, you use the latch register. And the direction of the port is decided by the TRIS register. So that is the purpose of having the port, TRIS and latch registers of the microcontroller I/O ports. So as discussed in the program, first TRIS A, that is because we want to make the entire port as an output port. So we have loaded with 00. After that, since the LEDs are connected on A.4 and A.5, as we have seen in the circuit diagram, A.4, A.5 of the microcontroller are connected to the LEDs, that is A4 and A5. So in the program, where first in the latch register A, we are writing 0x30. 0x means hexa value 30, so that A.4 and A.5 will be high state. And then a delay, a for loop delay is written here based on the operating speed of the microcontroller. Then there is a latch, again we are writing as a 00, and this is in the infinite loop, while 1 is an unconditional loop. So the bits will be set and clear of A.4 and A.5. So once you write the program, you can build the project, say go to project and build all. So it should say that build is succeeded. So once this is done, then as discussed that we have a HID bootloader.exe file, you can start this. Now before you download the program on the board, as you can see, there are two switches are there. One is called boot, other is called reset. So if you want to load the program, so first press the boot, then reset, release reset, release boot. So you will notice that this HID bootloader is now activated. So it's that means the USB is activated, in short. So you can open the hexa file, then the LED program which you want to load, you can select that hexa file, say open, and then you can say program the flash memory. Once the programming is done successfully, now you can see it is ready. So now either you can press this reset button or you can select this reset device. So from here also you can reset the device. Now I will reset this. Now you will see the LEDs which are on A.4 and A.5 will be blinking on your board. So this is the first example where we have initialized the port A as the output port. Then in the latch register of port A, we are writing A.4, A.5 active high and active low, because in the design the LEDs are common cathode. So one means on, zero means off. So let us see the second example. The second example is, let us use the entire port B, which is there on the board. On the board, as we can see, on the corner side, on top of the switch, there is entire port B connector is provided on a 5x2 connector. So let us use this entire port B. As you can see, left side all even number of pins are there, right side odd number of pins are there. Pin number 9 is VCC, 10 is ground. So let us interface 8 LEDs to this port, entire port B, and switch on the LED one at a time from left to right, and then rotate it from right to left, the contents, by using some operators, C operators. So in the program, in the examples, as you can see, in the example, Amtron LED 2 example, let us use that. So in that, the beginning of the code is same, where we have initialized the reset interrupt vector and the reserved space for the high interrupt and low interrupt vector locations. And in the main program, since we are using port B, so entire port B, tris B is 0, so that entire port B will be output port. And in the while loop, what we are trying to do is, we have assigned I, integer, as a FF hexa value, and that contents we are writing into port B, latch B. And then, as you can see, we have written a for loop. In the for loop, contents of the port B, we have assigned I, and the I we are left shift, lesser left shift by 1 bit for 8 times. So for loop we have used. So contents of port B will be left shifted by 1 bit 8 times, and between every shift there is a delay. So that will rotate, will give a like a rotate the contents of port B. Then similarly, after 8 times, contents of port B will be right shifted by 1 bit with a delay of 500 milliseconds. So by using a normal C program like for loop, and then operators like lesser for left shift, greater for right shift, we will see how the contents of port B will be shifted 1 bit at a time from left to right and right to left. So after project, built all, as you can see on the board, first press the boot, reset, release reset, release boot. Now as you can see, the buttons are activated. Go to open hexa file. So second LED2 example, open program. Okay, now we need to interface 8 LEDs to the board on this connector, port B connector. So these 8 LEDs we will connect it to the port B. As you can see, there is a notch on the connector. So exactly the notch should go to the notch of the 5x2 connector. Okay, so now these 8 LEDs, we want to make them left shift and right shift. Once I reset the program, you will notice how the contents are getting modified. Okay, so this demonstrates how the port contents can be rotated from left to right, right to left by using the logical operators of the C program. The next example is how to make the port as an input port. As we know, there are number of examples where we can interface the switches, sensors, where we need to read the data. In the board, we have a switch, which is this, a boot switch, what is called, is connected to port B, PB4. So this switch. Now here, as you can see in the circuit diagram, the RB4 is connected to VCC by 10 kilo ohms resistor. That means when the switch is not pressed, RB4 is active high, and if the switch is pressed, RB4 will be zero. So let us write the contents of port B. Let us read these contents and write to the LED which is connected on port A, PA4, which is a common cathode. So in the program, the example number, project, open, second example, LED switch 1. So in this example, apart from the previous code, how we have written, the only difference here is we are using two ports, that is port A and port B. In TRIS A, when we loaded 00, that means entire port A will become output port, because there we have LED is connected. Then in TRIS B, writing 10 hexa value into TRIS B register, make the port B 0.4 as a input port. In the while loop, infinite loop, we are reading port bits RB4. As we have discussed, whenever you want to read, you must use the port B register contents RB4, and we are writing to the port A4. Here you can use either latch register or a port register. So A4, we are writing the contents of B4 in the loop. So once you load this program after compiling, so first release reset, release boot, open hexa file. So Amtron LED switch 1. Open program. Now then reset the device. As you know, now the LED is getting on because initially the switch is connected to the VCC pull up. Now if I press the switch, you will notice the LED is off. If I release the switch, LED is on, because whenever I press the switch, the port bit is connected to ground. So that means 0 is written to the port in the switch. If you see RB4, whenever you press the switch, RB4 is 0. So that means PA4 will be 0, LED will be getting off. So that is how you can read the contents of the port by using port bit register, by making the port bit as a input port by writing 1 into the corresponding bit. So 0 means output, 1 means input for the ports. So that is decided by the TRIS register. Let's make a small variation in the program where we will use conditional statement to read the switch. So for example, if port B4, if it is 1, then we want to make LED on of A4. If port B4 is 0, then we want to make another LED A5 as a on. So when you release the switch, A4 LED will be on. When you press the switch, A5 LED will be on. So we have used, as you can see in the program, conditional statement. If this condition is satisfied, then whatever is written in the brackets will be executed. Otherwise, both the LEDs will be off. So this example is switch 2, LED switch 2 example. Let us load the program. So reset, boot, release reset, release boot. Open hexa file, switch 2, LED program. Program the flash memory, reset the device. As you can see, when the switch is not pressed, that means when the switch is released, RA4 LED is on. When I press the switch, that LED will be off. RA4 is off, but however, RA5 is on. When I release it, now again, RA4 is on. And there is a delay of 500 milliseconds. Okay, so that demonstrates how we can use conditional statements while reading the port bits, so that in sensored applications, in robotic applications, we can sense the sensors and accordingly switch on or switch off the motors. The next example is how to interface the text LCD to the PIC microcontroller. This text LCD is 16 characters. We can display in one line. Such type of lines are 2. It's called 16x2 LCD. We can also interface 16x24, 16x40 LCD to the same connector. Whenever you interface the LCD to the microcontroller, as you can see, the connector is a 16-pin connector. In that 16-pin connector, pin number 1 is ground, pin number 2 is VCC, pin number 3 is connected to ground by using 1 kilo ohms resistor, which will adjust the contrast of the character. By increasing or decreasing this R13, you can adjust the contrast on the LCD. Pin number 4 is control signal, RS. Pin number 5 is control signal again, read oblique write bar. Pin number 5 is again control signal, enable. Pin number 7 to pin number 14 is a data bus, that is D0 to D7. Pin number 15 is again VCC. Pin number 16 is ground. So 15 and 16 are meant for the backlit LED, that is the LO LED is on because of the pin number 15 and 16. And pin number 1 and 2 is the power for the entire LCD itself. So while interfacing this LCD, which requires 3 control signals and 8 data lines, we have ignored the pin number 6 to pin number 10. So instead of using 8 plus 3 I/O lines, we have used 4 plus 3, that is 7 I/O lines. So LCD can be interfaced either 8-bit mode or 4-bit mode. In our case, we are using 4-bit mode. That means the data bus, instead of D0 to D3, we have connected only D4 to D7. So we have to write the data to the LCD 4-bit at a time. That means nibble by nibble we'll have to write to the port. So for interfacing this LCD, we have used port D, as you can see, RD0, RD1, RD2. RD3 is not used, RD4 to RD7. So the significance is RD0 is reset signal, RD0 is register select signal, RS, RD1 is read oblique write bar, RD2 is enable. Then D4 to D7 data bus we have connected to RD4 to RD7. So whenever we write the data we write in nibble by nibble to RD4 to RD7. So that is how the PIC controller RD, entire port D, we have used for interfacing the LCD. So while writing the program, so while placing, as you can see how the connector is placed, there is a 16 pin connector next to the USB where we are writing the program. So always the LCD is positioned inside the board. As you can see physically, it is inside the board, not outside. So while mounting, one should be careful about that. So this is pin number 1 of the LCD. So in the program, go to project, open example number 3, Mtron LCD. So in this program, as we have discussed in the earlier programs also, the interrupt vector location we have not touched, that we kept it as it is. Then in the main program, this very simple 3 steps we said. One is we want to display this string on the LCD. So that string, 16 character string, we have stored in the array, what is called VAR1. And second string which we want to display, that we have stored in VAR2. Then we have called a function, this is called PIC initialization and LCD initialization. Once the microcontroller is initialized, then LCD is initialized. Then we have called another function called display string, which will display these two arrays on the LCD. So let us see what do you mean by PIC initialization function. So in PIC initialization function, as you can see, port D, entire port D, TRIS D, is we have stored with a value of 00, so that the entire port D will become output port where the LCD is connected. After that, we have called another function called LCD initialization. So this is a slightly a complex routine, because LCD itself is a as having a LCD controller. So whenever you want to communicate to the LCD, there are 3 control signals are there, what is called RS, read oblique write bar, and enable. So whenever RS, if you make this pin as a 0, that means the LCD will accept the control words. Whenever RS is 1, then LCD will accept the data. So control words means to reset the LCD, to clear the LCD, to blink the cursor, to change the size of the character, and so on. So that is the control words. And data means all the ASCII values, whatever you want to display, that is called data. So LCD always accepts the ASCII values to be displayed. So read oblique write bar, whenever you want to write anything to the LCD, it has to be 0. Enable, you have to make it low and high, what is called strobe, so that the whatever you write into the port, the LCD will accept the data. So since we want to reset the LCD first through software, you have to write 33 times to the LCD. So whenever you write the data to the port D of the microcontroller, as you can see, RS and read oblique write bar is 0. And then when we called one function called strobe, strobe means in strobe function, the port bit of the microcontroller, that is enable, will be low and high, so that whatever you have written the data 30 is accepted by the LCD. So to reset the LCD, we are writing 33 times to the data bus, that is port D of the microcontroller. Then the control words like function set, because we want interface in 4-bit mode, then two lines we want to display. Size of the character is 5x7 pixels. Cursor visible, auto increment mode of the cursor, and so on. So these are the control words of LCD. Any data sheet of LCD will tell you what are the control words. So 280F06 is for hardware initialization of the LCD. So whenever we are sending the control word, as we can see, we are calling one function called CMD function. Because after internal reset of the microcontroller, the microcontroller is now in, the LCD is in 4-bit mode. Because as we have discussed that we have not used the lower nibble D0 to D3, we are using upper nibble to write the data to the port. So for that purpose, we have to write the lower nibble on upper nibble portion. So that nibble by nibble, we will have to transfer the data. So only on the upper portion of D4 to D7 we'll have to write the data. So for that purpose we have written a function called CMD function. In CMD function, if you carefully notice that whenever we are writing MSB, then LSB we have masked, and whenever we are writing LSB, MSB is getting masked. So as you can see, LSB, when we are writing to the MSB, then we left shift the bits by 4 so that the D0 to D3 will appear on D4 to D7. So that is how we are writing the control word or in future data also using 4-bit mode of the LCD by shifting the LSB to the MSB position. So after initialization of the LCD, then we are calling one function called display string. So display string is whatever is that we have selected, that is after initialization, display string LCD. This function will display both the strings on LCD, which is a data now. So this entire string will be converted into corresponding ASCII value, and that value we are calling a function called display string. So whenever you want to display the string on LCD, the first line, if you want to display, then the address of the first line is called 80. So if you write 80 to the LCD, then whatever you write, it will display on first line. So 80 is a memory location, RAM address of the LCD. So first line, first character is 80. Second character is 81, last character is 8F. Similarly, if you want to display on the second line, the address of the RAM of the LCD for second line is C0, then C1, C2 up to CF. So first send a command called 80 so that you can display the string on first line. Then LCD write string, we are again called a function, so that this function will write the data to the LCD port. So in this function, now you can see first time we have made RS as a 1, because so far we have made RS as a 0, that is register selection as a 0, because LCD understands when RS is 0, that means you are writing the control word. When RS is 1, that means LCD considers that as a data, not as a control word. Whenever you write data or control, read/write bar has to be 0. And strobe signal, that means enable signal, has to be low and high so that it will accept the control word. Again, when you are writing the data, as we have seen that since we are using only the upper portion, the lower portion we are left shifting by 4 bits so that nibble by nibble we write the data to the LCD. So this loop will be executed till the entire string will be displayed, all 16 characters are displayed on the LCD. Once this is finished, then it will go to the second line by writing C0. Again, we are calling LCD write string. So this time string number 2 will be displayed on the LCD. Let's compile the program. Project build all. Then load the program. reset, boot, release reset, release boot. Open hexa file. Example number 3, Mtron LCD, hexa file, program and verify. Once the programming is done, reset the device. You will notice the text is displayed on the LCD. Let us see the most complex part of the microcontroller, that is the timers. PIC18F4550 has various timers, two external and one internal. So if you refer the data sheet, page 25, as you can see, various source of the oscillators, what is called crystal resonator, you can have with PLL, without PLL, high speed crystal you can have with PLL, without PLL, or you can also have a external clock source or external clock source with PLL, and then internal oscillator, you can have a inbuilt internal oscillator. So this is all programmable, as you can see, total 12 ways of choosing the clock source. You can see, for example, when you select a external clock, for example, you can say F oscillator divided by 4 you can have, or you want external clock with IO pin on RS6 pin number, port A6, or you want with PLL, which is inbuilt. So like that, one can choose what is the clock source and what is the operating speed of the microcontroller. So the microcontroller oscillator, if you see the sources, one is, as we have discussed earlier also, primary oscillator, then secondary oscillator, which is available on the port pins. You can enable or disable these pins with the help of the control bits. Then you have a PLL as a prescaler, so that whatever is the clock you have applied, you can generate, you can divide with a dividing factor, with PLL dividing factor, and you can generate a 4 megahertz. Once you derive 4 megahertz, then a PLL can convert that 4 megahertz into 96 megahertz. And that 96 megahertz can be used as a clock source for the USB peripheral, or you can also use that clock source with a dividing factor of 2, which can be used for USB. So this 96 megahertz, as you can see, again you can use a prescaler of 2, 3, 4, 6, which act as a clock source for the CPU. So for a USB, you have a USB division factor, for CPU you have a CPU division factor for this 96 megahertz. So finally, your clock source for the CPU is decided by the F oscillator control bits. So this primary clock source is again can be further divided by 4, which act as a USB peripheral. So you have various programmable clock sources in the PIC microcontroller. Similarly, you can also choose a secondary oscillator, where with the help of the control bits, you can enable or disable that, which also act as a clock source to the CPU or the peripherals. And finally, there is an internal oscillator, which is a 8 megahertz is the clock source. that can be again, you can have a prescaler so that that act as an internal oscillator to the CPU or the peripherals. So these are the various clock sources and the dividing factor for the microcontroller. Okay, so once you know these are the various clock sources and their division factor, when you we in our board, what the crystal which we have connected on the board is 20 megahertz. So as you can see on the board, the crystal which is here is a 20 megahertz, and then there are two biasing capacitors are there as recommended by the manufacturer. So when you connect a 20 megahertz high speed HS, we are using high speed crystal, 15 picofarad is the capacitors we have to be connected across the crystal as a biasing purpose. All right, so now let us see what do you mean by configuration, means how do you enable or disable these PLL or the internal dividing factor and so on. So if you refer the data sheet which is given in page number 288 of the data sheet, so in this you can see the configuration bits. Say when you have a special features of the CPU, like you can choose the oscillator, you can choose the reset, like it can be power on reset, brownout reset and so on, or interrupts, watchdog timers, code protection and so on. So various features are programmable with the help of the configuration bits of the microcontroller. So you can see the registers, configuration registers, configuration register 1L, 1H, 2L, 2H, 3H and 3 and so on. So these are the configuration registers where in the program also, whenever we are using, whenever we are writing in the program, we always said that interrupt vector table has to be initialized. So like that, similarly here configuration bit low and high, which is a 8 bit, you can see PLL dividing factor 1, 2, CPU dividing factor 0, 1, USB dividing factor. So these control bits has to be programmable so that these will decide the clock source and their operating speed. So let us look at a program. In the program, you can go to the project, open. Example number 4, MTROM timer 1. So in this example, to begin with, first time we are discussing about configuration of the microcontroller. You can see this configuration, config, that means it will initialize this control register, config register of the microcontroller, which will select various operating speed and the clock sources. So here as you can see, first F oscillator, what we have selected is the primary oscillator, is the high speed with the PLL. So that means when we have, since we have connected 20 megahertz as a crystal oscillator, we want the 20 megahertz to be with PLL function, which we have discussed in the earlier. And then we want that to be divided by 5, so that when we choose that dividing factor of 20 megahertz crystal with a dividing factor of 5 for PLL division, then the final frequency will be 4 megahertz, which act as a clock source to the PLL, where 96 megahertz will be generated. This is what we have discussed in the clock source. And then that 96 megahertz, we want to divide it by 2, so that finally the CPU will get 48 megahertz. So this is what is discussed in page number 32 of the data sheet. So here you can see the oscillator configuration bits. When your input frequency is 20 megahertz, choose the PLL dividing factor as a 5, so that you will generate 4 megahertz as a oscillator, and we are using high speed PLL as a clock source, so that we are using that when you say high speed PLL with a dividing factor of 4, that means we will generate the 96 megahertz, that we are doing divided by 2 factor, so that finally your microcontroller is operating at 48 megahertz. So this is what one has to carefully look at, with what speed your microcontroller is operating, what speed your peripherals are operating, what speed your USB is operating is very, very important. So hardware configuration is a very important factor. So this acts as a clock source. And then we said CPU dividing factor as a 2, so that your 48 megahertz. So this is the CPU dividing factor control bits. And the USB dividing factor, so that your USB operates from 96 megahertz, which is derived from the PLL. And rest of the configuration bits, as you can see, disable fail safe clock monitor, disable switchover mode, power on timer, brown out, and so on. So whichever is not important, though, like say for example watchdog timer, when you are not using, better disable the watchdog timer so that it won't reset the microcontroller, and master clear enable so that we can reset the microcontroller, and so on. So this is what is nothing but configuration of the microcontroller for various special features which are provided, and the operating speed. The first four lines are the operating speed. You can choose what is the operating speed. In this example, it is very, very important, because we should know with what speed the CPU is executing, with what speed the timer is working, so that you can actually calculate every T state of the timer for various applications. Okay, so in the main program, since we want to use the timer 0 of the microcontroller, so for timer 0, we need to understand what is the control register, which is given in pin number, page number 127. So timer 0 of this microcontroller, you can operate it in 8-bit mode, or you can operate in 16-bit mode. That means when you are operating in 8-bit mode, then it will start from 00, it will go to FF, and then will generate an interrupt on overflow. If you are operating on 16-bit mode, then it will start from 00000 to FFFF and will generate an interrupt on overflow. So if you carefully look at the how it works, as you can see, you can, in 8-bit mode only, it will use timer 0 LSB register only. When you are using 16-bit mode, timer 0 LSB and timer 1 MSB, higher byte of timer 0, so that it will act as a 16-bit mode. Okay, so there is only one control register for timer 0, that is called T0 CON register. So if you see this register, which is a 8-bit register, we'll decide the operating. So to start the timer in the T0 CON register, 8th bit will decide when to start the timer. So 1 means enable the timer, 0 means stop the timer. Similarly, if you want to operate on 8-bit mode or 16-bit mode, this T0 bit, 8-bit will decide. And then what is the clock source? Or you want to use the external clock source, or you want to use the internal clock source, is decided by this bit. And how to trigger, whether you want to trigger from high to low or low to high, is decided by this bit. And you want prescaler or not. If you say no, then prescaler won't be selected. If you say yes, then you have a choice of choosing the prescaler, with whether it is a divided by 2, 4, 8, 16, up to 256 is the dividing factor you can choose. So that is the reason where you can see, you can give the clock from externally, or you can choose the internal CPU clock of oscillator divided by 4, act as a clock source. And that can be further divided by your prescaler bit, so that finally you can choose the clock source. So this clock source is, again, you can enable or disable by the control bits. That means when to start, when to stop. So if you are using a 8-bit mode, only LSB is used. If you are using 16-bit mode, LSB as well as MSB both are used. So that is how a timer can be enabled or disabled. So in the example program, we said, as you can see, T0 configuration bit register, every individual bit we have selected. Like say, initially we said stop timer, then we want 16-bit mode, then we want the clock to be, system clock to be increment timer. Prescaler we want divided by 256, so whatever is the operating speed. interrupts in interrupt configuration bit, we have disabled the timer 0 interrupt because we do not want to use the interrupt mechanism. Now we have started the timer. Start the timer by saying timer 0 on bit. Alright. So since we want to switch on or switch off a LED, so that is why, as you can see, an RD4 where we want to RA4 we want to make it as a output port where the LED is connected. Same data we also want to bring it on port B, PB0, so that I can see it on the CRO, because A4 LED is connected, B0 we can see it on the CRO. Alright, so in the while loop we are continuously reading timer 0 LSB and timer 0 MSB, and then we pack it, and then we are comparing the timer value whether it has reached to 23441 or not. So this value is equivalent to 500 milliseconds, that is half a second. So how to calculate that? For example, if I want to have a delay of 500 milliseconds, then what should be the value of the timer? Alright, so as we have discussed, what are the factors? One is the operating speed, second is the initial count. So initial count we have started with 00. Obviously, we start from 00 and it will reach up to 23441. Now how this 23441 we have arrived? Right, now let's see the calculation. Since we have chosen F oscillator is a 48 megahertz, now it always divides the 48 megahertz divided by 4, F oscillator. That is what we have discussed in the data sheet also, that F oscillator divided by 4 is the operating speed of your timer. Alright, so that means when you say divided by 4, 4 by 48 megahertz will give you 83.33 nanoseconds, is equivalent to 1 T state of the timer. Alright, so this 1 T state we are dividing by, further divided by 256 is a prescaler. That means 83.88 nanoseconds, sorry, 33 nanoseconds multiplied by 256 will give you 21.33 microseconds is your actual clock, because we have in the prescaler value we have divided by 256 is being selected. Alright, so for a half a second what should be the count? So 0.5 divided by 21.33 microsecond will give you a value of 23441. So this is the value which we are comparing whether the timer has reached this value or not. So till this value reaches, the timer will be keep on incrementing. Once this value is reached, then we are using a pooling mechanism. So once this value is reached, then we are say XOR the port A bit, so that we can actually see then on LED whether it is blinking or not. Similarly, we also XOR the port PB0 bit so that we can connect a CRO. Once it reaches to this value, again we are resetting the timer value to 00. Alright, so 0.5 microseconds, 0.5 milliseconds is nothing but you have to derive it from 48 megahertz divided by 4 multiplied by 256 will give you 1 T state. So 0.5 divided by 1 T state will give you the actual value which you are looking for. So that is how the calculation goes. So once you compile your project built all, then you can load the program. Reset, boot, release, reset, release, boot. So open the exe file, mtron timer 1. Okay, then program, then reset the device. You can see this LED which is connected on PA4 bit is blinking at every half a second, at the same time on this port B connector on PB0, I have connected a CRO. This is ground. On LCD connector, last pin is ground. So CRO's ground is connected to the last pin of the LCD, and the first pin of port B we have connected to the CRO pin. Now you will notice that this signal is exactly, you can see the scale is 500 millisecond. So one division is equivalent to 500 milliseconds. So that is how the waveform is generated. So all the, that means the all the calculations are correct. So what it demonstrates is that, just to repeat, that we have selected the CPU with a high speed PLL, that means 20 megahertz is the crystal, that we have used a PLL, so 96 megahertz is derived, and that divided by 2 will give you 48 megahertz is your system clock. And then we have disabled the unwanted features of the microcontroller. And in timer 0, we have selected the clock, system clock, and then prescaler 256. That will give us a delay of 21.33 microseconds per T state. So since we want 0.5 as a second, so 0.5 divided by 21.33 microseconds will give us 23,441 as a count, which we need to look for timer 0, LSP and MSP. So once that is reached, then on port bits, we are toggle the bits or XR the bit so that it will be make on and off state. So that is how we are able to generate the desired value on the timer. So this demonstrates how accurately we can calculate the values by using a timer. In continuation to the previous example, in this example, let us see how to use the interrupts of a timer. So when the timer overflows, it will generate an interrupt. In the interrupt service routine, we will use the LED to indicate whether the timer is overflow or not. So for that, in the program, we have initialized TCON resistor with 16-bit mode and a prescaler of 1:256. And then the initial timer value we want to initialize with FFF0. Then the timer 0 interrupt flag we want to enable. So that is specified in interrupt con register, which is there in page 101. In IT con register, as you can see, there is a timer 0 interrupt flag and timer 0 interrupt enable and the global interrupt. So these bits has to be set in the program. As you can see, timer 0 interrupt flag initially we have cleared, and timer 0 interrupt enable we made it 1 so that it will accept the interrupt, and then we have started the timer. And global interrupt enable we have made it 1 so that it will accept the interrupts. And as you can see in the main program, do nothing while 1 infinite loop. So once the timer is initialized, once the interrupts are initialized, we are doing nothing. Now in the foreground loop, as you can see, there is a ISR of the timer. When this interrupt is generated, that is interrupt on overflow, then we will initialize again the timer with the in same value F0, FFF0. Then in order to indicate the interrupt is generated, let us switch on the LEDs which are connected on port A, that is RA4 and RA5. So then switch off the LEDs and again clear the interrupt flag so that it is ready for the next overflow interrupt to occur. So that is how we can verify whether the timer 0 overflow interrupt is generated or not. In the previous program, we are continuously verifying the flag by using pooling mechanism, but here we are using the interrupt mechanism. So if you load the program, so the example is for example timer 2. So this is the example we want to load. So HID bootloader, which is a loader program, right? It's not activated. Now on your board, you have to first press reset boot, release reset, release boot. Now the buttons are activated. Open the hexa file, that is timer 2 program. Flash is programmed. Now you can reset the device. Now you can see these LEDs which are blinking, because this is happening because in the ISR, timer 0 ISR, we said switch on the LEDs which are connected on bit 4 and bit 5. So this demonstrates how the time so in this example we will see the analog to digital converter of the PIC microcontroller. PIC 18F4550 has 10 bit A to D converter. The total number of channels are 12 and the resolution is 10 bit. So if you refer the circuit diagram where port A has the ADC, that is AN0, AN1, AN2, AN3, AN5, AN6, AN7 on port E and so on. So in order to write the program for the A to D converter, first in the port A we will use channel number 0 because we have provided channel number 0 separately on the connector. As you can see, RA0 is the center pin. One side there is a VCC, other side there is a ground. So by connecting a potentiometer here, we will give the variable input to the RA0. So let us make RA0 as a A to D converter. So TRIS register and TRIS register A, we make it both of them A0 and A2 as a 1-1. So that is because, as you can see, for example, in TRIS register, if you make it this TRIS register as a 1, so then in case of a analog input, right, it will act as a, the channel act as a analog to digital converter input. So it will accept the input as a analog input. And similarly, the other channels also, as and when you are using other channels, you will have to make them as a analog input channels by writing them as a 1. So once the ADC port line, wherever it is there, that is made as an analog input, then we have one control register in A to D converter, which is given in page number 261. So as you can see, there are three control registers, AD con 0, con 1, con 2. These three control registers, first we can select with which channel we want to convert analog to digital form. If you want AN0, then CHS0 to CHS3. So that is bit number D2 to bit number D5. We'll have to make it 00 so that channel number 0 will be selected. And then in order to select the A to D converter, AD on has to be 1. And the bit number 1 will indicate whether the ADC is in an ideal state or conversion is in progress. Right. So basically in AD con 0, we are loading 01 so that we will select channel number 0. And ADC is on. Then AD con 1, we want to select the reference voltage. So that is if you see AD con 1, so where first of all this PCF 0 to PCF 3, where we want to make them as a analog input. So that means we want to select this 1110, so that only channel number 0 is the analog input. So let's write this PCF 0 to PCF 3 as 1110. Then the reference voltage, the that is VCF 0 and VCF positive reference and negative reference is decided by bit number 4 and 5. So that is about as far as the AD con 1 register is concerned. Then about the operating speed of the ADC is decided by AD con 2, where you can choose the how much time it will take to convert analog to digital form. Say for example, if you are choosing F oscillator divided by 64, that means this ADS 0 to ADS 2, you will have to load 110. Similarly, A to D conversion time select bits. So if you want at least 12 clock cycles, then 101. And how do you want to adjust the data? Like a truncation. If it is right justified, then this ADC FM has to be 1, that is bit number 7. So the AD con will decide the operation time and the 10 bit resolution A to D converter. Okay, so once the analog to digital conversion is done, we want to display it on LED. So on port B, where 8 LEDs on our board, there is a port B, we separately brought it out on the connector, which is available on the board. Let us switch off the unwanted layers. Okay, so if you see the port B is available here. So ADC is this, so channel number 0. So let us connect a potentiometer here and 8 LEDs on this port B, so that whatever is the analog to digital data, that we will display it on the LEDs. So that is the reason in TRIS B we have loaded 0, so that entire port B will be output port. Okay, then in AD con register, where we have discussed here, let us make the go bit as a 1 so that the conversion will start. And then in the same register, we will read done bit, whether the conversion is completed or not. Once the conversion is completed, so let it be in the wait loop. Once it is done, then read the data register, that is ADRESL and ADRESH, which is a 10 bit data is there. So in order to make it 10 bit data, let us left shift the higher byte by 8 bits and then OR with the LSB, so that you will get a packed 10 bit data of a high byte. So this we temporarily store it in a bin temp register, and the same contents as it is write it to the latch register of the port B, so that the A to D converted data is available on port B. Rest of the program is same because we are using the USB for programming purpose. So the interrupt vector table is as is initialized the way we have initialized else. Okay, so let's load the program. Mtron ADC2 program and reset. Now, as you can notice, when the potentiometer is at the higher side, maximum 5 volt is applied to the A to D converter. Now, as I vary the signal, you will notice the change in corresponding analog data in digital form on LCD. So this demonstrate how to use the A to D converter of the PIC 18F4550 microcontroller, and then once we have connected a potentiometer on channel number 0, and then the converted data we have displayed on LCD, which is connected on port D, RD0 to RD7. Where we have used the 4-bit form of the LCD, where we are sending the data nibble by nibble. So this example is to demonstrate the serial port of the PIC controller. There are various serial ports, but in this example we are using UART of the PIC controller. If you can notice, pin number 1, which is RC7, also act as a received data, and pin number 44, which is RC6, which act as a transmitter. So this TXT and RXT signals are implementing the UART protocol. So these two signals, if you want to use it for a data transfer, then you require another system which will receive the data, transmit the data. So we will connect the computers. We will use computer as a data transfer to the microcontroller. But assume that if computer doesn't have serial port, then how to transmit this UART protocol to the computer? So in this example, on the board, we will notice there is another IC called F2232 IC. So this will convert this RS232 protocol, that is TXT, RXT signals, into the USB protocol, that is the differential output of DPP and DPM. So whenever you are whenever you interface this RC6 and RC7 to this device, then this output of this, you can connect what is written as a UART, that you can connect it to the computer's USB. So that through computer will initialize as a virtual serial port. Though physically it is not present, but USB it will dynamically assign as a virtual port, so that the USB protocol is implemented in UART form. So if you see the placement of the components, the UART is the outermost side of the PCB, where you can connect it to the computer's USB port. So if you see the physically placement, this is where the USB we are using for programming purpose, but now we will use this USB for data transfer application. So since the F232 IC is mounted here on the PCB, the moment if you connect this to the USB, you will notice that it will recognize the device. So if you go to the your device driver, so in device manager, so right now the moment if I connect it to the USB, you will notice the computer has automatically has assigned some number COM27. So in case if this is a question mark, then you can right click and update the driver of the F2323 driver file. Since it is already installed, so it has recognized, so it has assigned COM27. So henceforth for data transfer we will have to use COM27 as a port address. Okay, so now let us see the programming example. The programming example, you can go to the project and open. The example is 6th example, COM1, MTRON COM1. So in this example, first of all, we are using the same initialization of the PLL and the clock sources the way we have done in the timer program. So as you can see, HSS PLL is initialized. That means we want to use the 20 megahertz crystal. And then by using the PLL, it generates 96 megahertz. And then we divided it by 4 so that we will derive the 4 megahertz. So finally, the 96 megahertz is divided by 2 to get the F oscillator clock, what is called 48 megahertz. So that is the reason in configuration bits, what we have explained in the timer is initialized in such a way that the CPU is operating on 48 megahertz. Then the unwanted configuration bits we have disabled, like watchdog timer and so on. And in the main program, as you can see, like in earlier programs, we have used interrupt vector table. But in this program, we have not initialized any default interrupt vector table because we are not using, in this example, this USB port for programming purpose. In this case, what we will show you is how to program the microcontroller by using its in-system programming. So there is a ISP connector is there, the 6-pin connector on the board, where this is the pin number 1, that is the one which is towards the microcontroller, is pin number 1. Okay, so on the circuit diagram, you can see there is a connector, 6-pin connector. So pin number 1 is your reset master clear, what is written as a VPP. So this is master clear. Pin number 18 is connected here. Then 2 is VCC, 3 is ground, and these ISP signals, the PGD, PGC, PGM, which is available here. So these three signals are responsible for programming the flash memory of the microcontroller. So either you can load the boot program or you can load the application program. So in order to program this, now we will use the PIC3 programmer. So on PIC3, you will notice there is a pin number 1. So that pin number 1 has to be connected to pin number 1, that is master clear signal of the board. So this arrow indicates the pin number 1 that has to be connected to the board pin number 1. Okay, so now we will be programming by using this in-system programming ICS connector of the PIC controller. Alright, so now let us see the programming. So the transmitter status and control register, TXSTA register, which is a 8-bit register, whereas you can see the control bits, like whether you want to transmit 8-bit data or 9-bit data. In our case, we want to transmit 8-bit data. Then you want to enable or disable the transmitter. So that is TX enable bit. So we want to enable the transmitter. Then about the high speed operation of the baud rate or low speed operation of the baud rate. So BRGH will decide the baud rate calculation. So we are selecting BRGH as a 0 so that all our calculations are based on the low speed. So that is how the transmitter status and control register has to be initialized for 8-bit transmission and transmitter enable, asynchronous mode and low speed. Then about the receiver status and control register. So here again, we are not using 9th bit, so we are using only 8-bit reception. So this has to be 8-bit reception. Then we are using asynchronous communication mode. So that has to be in asynchronous mode, where we will be using transmitter as well as receiver. So if you say that configured as a RXT and CCXT pin, so SPEN signal has to be 1. So this will initialize the one is the 8-bit reception mode and enable the receiver. Then about the baud rate configuration, about the BRG 16, we want 8-bit baud rate generation, not 9-bit, not the 16-bit. So here you see the baud rate configuration register, so BRG 16, this bit we are making as a 0, so that our baud rate calculation is reflected by only one register, what is called SPBRG data register, not 16-bit register, 8-bit register. Now loading the baud rate itself in the SPBRG register. So we have loaded decimal number 77. That means for a baud rate of 9600, so how to calculate the SPBRG data register value? So there is a formula is given in page 21. So say for example, as we have discussed, we are using synchronous asynchronous communication mode and the low speed operating mode, and we are using only LSB of the register, so 8-bit asynchronous mode. So for that, the formula is F oscillator divided by 64 into n plus 1 is the formula. So some based on that, some values are given. If you look at the table, say for example, if your CPU is operating on 40 megahertz and if you want 9600 as a baud rate, then SPBRG register value is 64. But in our case, operating frequency is 48 megahertz, then obviously this value will turns out to be 77. So that is the reason where SPBRG register is 77. While choosing, one should be careful. There will be always some percentage of error. The error should be less than 1%, so that it won't affect your data. So after that, then there is a in TRIS register, RC6 has to be 0, because now when we want to make it transmitter as output port, so then this bit will be 0. Similarly, receiver, we want to make it as an input, then RX pin has to be 1, that is in TRIS bit, RC7 has to be 1, so that act as a digital input. Alright, so then about the interrupts. Since we want to transmit or receive the data by using interrupt mechanism, so then we'll have to initialize the interrupt control registers. So first is about the IPEN interrupt priority, enable or disable, which is given in page number 110. So as you can see in RCON control register, that is the reset control register, IPEN, whether you want to enable or disable the interrupt priority. So right now we do not want to have any priority, so we have made it as a 0, so that no priority is used. Then about the to enable the interrupts, there is a global interrupt and there is a peripheral interrupt has to be enabled, which is explained in page 101. So that is about the interrupt control register. As you can see, global interrupt enabled, so this has to be enabled whenever you want to accept any of the interrupts. Similarly, the peripheral interrupt enable, PIE bit, has to be 1 in order so that the peripherals can generate the interrupt request. So these two has to be 1. Now about the UART receiver interrupt. So whenever the data is received into the receiver buffer, it has to generate an interrupt. So that is given in page 106. So in the peripheral interrupt enable register, you can see receiver interrupt enable. This UART receiver interrupt enable has to be set 1, so that whenever receiver receives the data, it will generate an interrupt. So that completes the initialization. First we have initialized the transmitter with 8-bit transmission asynchronous and a low speed. Then we have initialized the receiver with 8-bit transmission and then transmitter and receiver is enabled, and the baud rate is initialized with a 8-bit form. So we have calculated based on the 48 megahertz is the CPU operating frequency. So 9600 is the baud rate. For that we have calculated a value which is turns out to be 77. Then the ports RC6, RC7, where exactly this transmitter and receiver is there. So those RC7, which is the receiver, and RC6, which is the transmitter, so they has to be initialized as a first as output transmitter and one as a input, that is the receiver. And then about the interrupts. So in this program we want to use the interrupts. So obviously we'll have to enable the global interrupt without any priority. We want to use the peripheral interrupts, and then receiver interrupt we have enabled, so that now as you can see there is a interrupt service routine for the receiver. So now this interrupt service routine we want to be stored at 08 location. That's why we have mentioned the absolute address of the ISR, so that this is the interrupt vector location of the receiver interrupt. So whenever a interrupt is received, as you can see, we are verifying RCIF bit is set or not. So this bit will be, we are comparing whether any data is received or not. If the data is received, then we want to verify whether the transmitter registry is empty or not. Because this flag, if it is not empty, that means it is previous data still in transmission mode. So once it is empty, then whatever is the data received in the receiver buffer, that we want to write it to the transmitter buffer, so that this program will demonstrate whatever is received will be reflected back, will be echoed back. So in this program, as we have seen, we are not using any USB program. So no, the initial default USB related default interrupt service routines are initialized. It is just a simple program without using any USB firmware. So after compiling this program where built all, so we will be, as explained, we will be programming by using the PICIT controller. So for that, now the programmer has to be selected, what is called PICIT 3. So this has to be selected. So after that, you can go to the your project, and once you said built all, then you can reconnect where the PICIT is connected. Now it has to be connected. So now it indicates that PICIT target device is detected. Once it is detected, then now you can say program. So whatever is your compile program is being programmed, it is loaded. So now, as I said, that we are transmitting the data through serially. So we will use this FT232 device USB connector, that is this serial port, to receive the data. So how to see this data? Whatever is sending through USB, we have connected to the computer's USB, but how to read the data? So there is a software called Flash Magic. Earlier there used to be Hyper Terminal, but after Windows 7 it is discontinued. So with this tool we have used in ARM processor and 8051. So you can go to the tools, and in terminals, as you can see, COM27. Is exactly we have to select it, because that's exactly the USB port is dynamically assigned, and the baud rate is 9600. You can say okay. Now you will notice if you type any character in the on the input section, the output section, it will be reflected back. That is because it is happening, the USB is communicating through UART protocol on your board. So that is, this is happening. Just to confirm, for example, if I remove this USB, you will notice it won't be reflected back.